Today's format, you all know Joshua, our speaker. He liked what the minister did last time she was here so much. He says, Anton, I'm willing to try that. Let's do that. So we're going to get a very short presentation, and then it's into Q&A. So get your questions ready, and then we'll have a discussion going. So other than that, I think you're on.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and more importantly, for the chance to be here, and thank you for making time in your day. This is a really, really nice opportunity to come and to really just do two things. One is to share a couple thoughts after a good 7 weeks on the job, and the second really is just to continue a process I started even just before I got to HQO, which is just to learn and to listen and to have conversations. And it's been great. There's a large number of people in the room who have already benefited from in terms of their wisdom, and many more that I'll be speaking to actually in the days ahead, Michael, I think next week. Just again, really appreciate the opportunity to chat. I knew there'd be questions. Fortunately, many of the staff at HCO are here, so there's good people to answer the questions. So they didn't know that's why they're here, but now they do. So I did want to, before we get to the questions, talk a little bit about some of the interesting things I've sort of been hearing as I've started to have a chance to talk to quite a few people in the last few weeks. And that'll take just a few minutes to share some of what I see as both real opportunities, somebody might call them challenges, and then just some real tensions. And some of these tensions are things that we might actually discuss as part of the questions. And one of the things I want to do before I get to that, actually, is to talk to you very quickly about my own sort of very sort of journey in quality. As people know, I'm a family doctor. I was an ADM. I spent a little bit of time at ISIS and worked at Sunnybrook and done a lot of clinical work. And people would sort of say, you know, you're not one of those guys with a master's in quality, or, you know, this hasn't been sort of your career sort of focus per se. And that's true. But as anybody in the healthcare system does, you bump up against quality everywhere and all the time. And I want to share three moments that have always stuck with me. And this is the front door of Dryden Hospital in northwestern Ontario. And I spent most of my first 2 to 3 years in practice in this eMERGE and in the clinic right next door. And I remember in my first year of practice after graduating, it's a time when you have a lot of catecholamines going all the time, your first year, especially in eMERGE. And quite a young girl came in, very young, and she had walked into a coffee table, and she had really smashed her upper lip and done it wasn't horrible and the teeth were fine and all that, but she'd really cut her upper lip. And as many of the people in the crowd will know, repairing the lip is really important, because that very thin edge, the vermilion border, that where the white meets the red, you really have to get it just right. Because otherwise, especially in a young child, especially in a young woman, it can be very visibly noticeable as they age. Like any just a millimeter or two off, really, it can be quite cosmetically functional, defect. And I had done a lot of my training in urban areas, and the rule was very clear that when you had an injury to the face that affects the vermilion border, that affects that, and you have an injury there, you call plastics. And so I saw this young girl with her dad. And of course, very committed to providing the highest quality care. I said, you know what, I'm going to get on the phone to Winnipeg, which was our major referral center. We're quite far west in Dryden. And I'm going to get plastics, and we'll get you an appointment later today. And obviously, this doesn't warrant an air ambulance out. You're going to have to drive there, and I apologize, but there is a Northern Ontario travel voucher. You'll get reimbursed if you need to stay overnight. There's payment for that, so it's not going to cost you anything. And the dad sort of said, you know what, I trust you. You go ahead and you sew it. And so we sat down and we had a very good conversation about why I was concerned, what it was. There was no I was going to say there's no internet to make me sound like 190 years old. There was an internet, but it was not, you know, today I'd probably just pull out my, you know, my digital device and we'd look at pictures online together. I think I remember pulling out an anatomy book and talking to the dad about it. We had a very good conversation about expectations, what it meant for him to have chosen to live in a rural area, what it meant for me to talk about high quality care and making sure the best for every patient I saw. And we had this very, very interesting conversation. And at the end of the day, I did repair it and it worked out very, very well. I stayed in Dryden on and off for many years, and I actually, being a small community, we connected again through the Emerge again, as what happens when you have small kids. And it worked out well, but it was a very, very interesting conversation for me about quality, what it means for me, what it means for my patient. The second thing that really was memorable for me was Andre Lalonde was the executive director of the Society of Obstetricians and Gynecologists of Canada. And he didn't present this graph, but he presented a graph a lot like this. And this is, what is the rate of C-sections at hospitals? And he actually presented to me, and I remember this to this day, what is the rate of C-sections in 10 hospitals in one of our LINs? And he showed me this graph about the unbelievable rate of variation. And so on this graph is actually an even more detailed. It's all the hospitals in Ontario that are providing C-sections, and what is the rate of C-section, and they have really controlled here. They have done, there's 10, there's actually for the obstetricians in the crowd, they will know the coding. There's 10 different ways of classifying cesarean sections and when you have them. And so this is really taking down and only controlling for 2 out of the 10. So women who have never been pregnant before, who have only one baby, no twins, no triplets, where the head is faced, you know, where the head is down, it's not transverse, it's not a breech, where they're at term, it's not preterm, it's not post-date, where it's spontaneous labor and it's either induced. And then they said, and we're just to better control the data, you know, we really want this as clean as possible. If there's a cord prolapse, we're not going to count it. If they have diabetes, we're not going to count it. If the placenta's in the wrong place, we're not going to count it. We really want this data to be as clean and tight as possible. If there's other mother maternal health issues, maybe the mother has a cardiac abnormality that's leading to the C-section, the baby has some concerns, we're going to make this data as clean as possible, as tight as possible, as narrow as possible. 8 entire categories for C-section we're not even going to include, just these 2. And he showed me basically this graph for 10 hospitals. I'm showing it to you for the province. And look at what the percentage difference is across the province between a 4.5% on one sort of pattern in one hospital cesarean section to 35.5. And he showed me this rate of variation for 10. I'm showing it more broadly. And I just remember being struck. And I wasn't, you know, on the quality agenda. I was the HHR guy, you know. I'm sure he was just there to talk to me about training more midwives. He said, but by the way, well, after talking about training more midwives and more obstetricians and more family doctors to do it, I should show you this graph. And really, the graph is all I really remember. And this is the update. And I just remember it. And this is a pager. And so most people won't remember these anymore, other than, as somebody said to me, somebody else actually saw this, I think Avery Nathan's tweeted this, other than drug dealers and doctors, nobody uses these anymore. And I was very involved in education, as people know, and I got asked to review a case. And it was a case in which a resident, surgical resident, had been involved in the care of a post-operative patient that their team had operated on. The patient wasn't doing well. They were paged 3 or 4 times over the course of several hours as the nurse got more concerned about the patient. And ultimately, the patient continued to deteriorate and died. And I was asked to review the case because it was a learner and I was sort of an education guy. And at first, it just looked like a pretty simple case, right? You know, you look at the chart, vital signs not so good, person paged. Vital signs still not so good, paged, still not overturn, and so on. And it's sort of nicely documented. You know, sort of, it's easy, right? Here's a person who just couldn't be bothered to answer the pagers, and because of that, there was an adverse outcome in our healthcare system. So I sort of said, well, you could look at it that way. Let's start talking to people, right? Like, it looks pretty slam dunk, 3-4 pages over 12 hours over the course of that overnight shift or whatever. And, well documented. But as we explored this case over a day, and then a week, and then a month, what we actually found was, you know, for me, learning about alarm fatigue, of which there is a whole literature. Learning about culture in institutions, learning about communication styles, learning about tradition, learning about how people prioritize and compete, learning about how we communicate using different technologies, learning about different sets of expectations. And what became what you thought was actually a very clear case became this incredibly thoughtfully complicated issue about how do we actually create systems that can continuously improve and that can avoid negative outcomes. And this wasn't obviously just, you know, this gets into how we structure educational systems, how we structure supervision, how we structure our relationships between different people and healthcare providers who work together at the front lines, how like I said, we use technology in different ways to communicate, and how each devices and different devices work and don't work together. And so these three stories, from this young girl in Dryden to system-level data about remarkable levels of variation in just one province, for just one procedure, for just one type of patient, to what looks like a very simple case and, in fact, is just buried in history, tradition, culture, technology issues, communication issues, have all been really three points in my career that have made me excited about the opportunity at HQL. And understand the need for it. So as people know, and I'm not going to spend a lot of time because this is an incredibly knowledgeable crowd, HQO is a great organization, a great agency of government, arm's length agency. It was created about 3 years ago under ECFA, the Excellent Care for All Act of 2010. It brought together a number of different organizations in order to meet its mission. And there are sort of three historical core pieces to this organization. The first is sort of, what does the evidence tell us that we should and shouldn't be doing? The second is, how do we start to drive change and innovation and scale and spread in the system? And the third is, how do we monitor and report on it? And those are the three core functions that HQO delivers in many different ways in many different places across the province with a lot of different tools. And you know, there's a lot of amazing things that the agency does to help do those three things: to find the evidence, help drive change and support and scale and spread throughout the province, and then report on it to the public. And when I say the public, that includes everybody from the health minister to front lines, and more broadly, what the lay public, if you will, and patients. So I've been talking a little bit to people about what are the opportunities to think differently about what's going forward. And in fact, I've heard dozens and dozens of opportunities. But I'm going to talk about six today that I really want to highlight very quickly. So the first is around electronic health records. And I don't know why this surprises me, because as a family doctor, I live this sort of every day, and I've lived this for the last several years. But you know, people are sort of saying, especially in primary care, especially in the community, you know what, I finally got this great computer on my desk, and the government's put, you know, huge resources behind this, and Ontario MD, I've got this here, and now there's two big problems. The first is that my computer doesn't talk to anybody else's computer. And so as my patient makes a journey through the healthcare system, my piece of technology cannot talk to their piece of technology. And how can I help ensure quality when even when we're across the street from each other, the two pieces of technology don't work? The piece of technology I carry in my pocket won't talk even to the one on my desk, won't talk to the tablet that I carry in my white coat, and so on, never mind once they actually leave my part of the healthcare system. And there's exceptions, places like Barrie, et cetera, who've got some pretty awesome stuff going. But for the most part, that's huge. And the second thing they say is, you know what, the reason I did this wasn't just to get rid of paper, it was to improve the quality of care. But it is really hard to get any data out of this computer on my desk in a meaningful, easy way to actually give me the feedback that I need. I can't, you know, a warning comes out about a drug, it's hard to pull that data out. It's hard for me to pull the blood pressure. Why? Because sometimes I write HTN for hypertension, sometimes I write BP hyphen, sometimes I write BP colon, sometimes I write the fact that they're going through a divorce under the social history, sometimes I write about it under ongoing issues, and sometimes I just put it in the core of the piece. Sometimes I write as a final assessment, acute transitional stress disorder. Sometimes I just write divorce. And for all of those different, and what I do, and I have variability, so do everybody else in my practice. And for those reasons and many, many other reasons, it's really hard to get the data you need out of the boxes we've now started to use. And this is a huge issue. Hospitals, to be fair, are pretty advanced, and they've got sometimes pretty good teams of people embedded in them. But primary care is a massive part of our healthcare system. It is a great opportunity for quality. The minister at the AFTO conference said quality starts in primary care this year when she spoke at the conference. And the ability to use technology in that setting is really quite limited. And we have so many different technologies, even just in primary care. The second is data. Data is in many ways part of the cornerstone, not the whole piece, but part of what the cornerstones are of driving a quality agenda. And we were talking to Nirav Shah, who is a state commissioner for health in New York. He was up this week and had a chance to meet with Linda and myself and others. And they talk about sending fresh data out to their cardiologists every 30 days. And that means that over a very short period of time, on elective stents, percutaneous cardiac intervention, cardiac stenting, applying the evidence, what they have seen is a drop from 23% to 9% by every 30 days sending out the latest data about what they're doing relative to the American Heart Association guidelines, the cardiology guidelines, against their personal performance, their performance of their peer, their hospital, the region, and against the guidelines. 23% to 9% closer adherence to the guidelines of PCI. And think about all the other patients that are now getting care in a more timely way, the right patients now, and the resources that have been freed up. So one of the privileges I had at Sunnybrook was to participate on one of our priority quality improvement indicators, a key area, which is hospital readmission, 30-day readmission data. So how often do you think, so I can actually calculate every day what my 30-day readmission rate for my hospital. The problem is that there's a lot of hospitals in my area. So not all of my patients come back to my hospital. So really I need collected data from the region to do it. So our overall readmission rate is about 18%, which is just under the provincial average, 18 to 19%. 12% to 13% on average are come back to Sunnybrook, but there's a delta there, 6 to 7%. Where do they go? How big that delta is? Is it getting bigger or smaller? And the overall readmission rate. That data tends to lag 14 to 16 months, right? So much of our data lags months to years. So how can you give thoughtful feedback, as the evidence talks about, when our data systems are refreshing that infrequently? And I know people like Matt have tremendous expertise in this area. So the ability for us to get robust data systems that are updated frequently, that are clean and of high value, is a huge challenge. And we've done it in places like wait times. Like, we know we can do this around some of our surgical wait times, but we need to do more. The other thing that Nirav Shah talked a lot about, and I work in a mainly homeless population now, so this is really something that I guess I really see my patients live through every week, is the social determinants of health. And I think, I won't spend a lot of time, you could spend 3 days on this, we do need a health and all policy. We will not actually drive a quality agenda for our province and for the patients who really need it most by focusing only on what we bring through the lens of the healthcare. It has to be all the things that contribute to health: education, nutrition, housing. Almost all of my patients are transiently sheltered or homeless. As I work at Seton House, which is a homeless shelter for 600 men. And it's actually what I can do is incredibly small. And I remember talking to somebody and trying to get them to take their HIV meds. And and they said, I'd really like you to get back on your HIV meds. I think it's really important, and I'd like you to get your CD4 counts and your liver test. Really be very important to me. And they said, I hear you, But there's a couple things that I'm really focused on right now. First of all, I haven't really eaten in 2 days. Second of all, unless I'm out working the streets and I'm going home with somebody who's paying for it, I don't have a place to stay because I don't want to stay in the shelters, and they had a lot of thoughtful reasons why. And so I haven't eaten, I don't have a place to stay. In order to work the streets, to have a place to stay, I have to be pretty high to tolerate the abuse and what I experience with that. And so I need money for the substance use in order to get myself in a state of mind to be able to do something to allow me to have a roof over my head. And so I hear you about your HIV medication, and you want to send me to St. Mike's for an appointment to meet with that HIV specialist. But I got a couple other things here I really need to think about right now and focus on. And when I have a roof over my head and a steady set of meals, I actually will do exactly what you want. But I need to get these things underway first. And that makes sense to me. But it isn't delivered through the Ministry of Health. And I think we need to involve the patients. And again, the Minister of Health, the Chief, this year said, we don't need a system designed for the patients, we need a system designed with the patients. We all talk about quality because we want things to be better for the patients. But we can't sit here in rooms like this and in other rooms and say, this is what quality will mean for them. We actually need them to be in the room with us saying, actually, this is what quality means for us. This is what we would value. And you know, we choose all the time. There's probably everybody here, I would guess, you know, there will be an exception. The vast majority of the people here are in some way involved in picking a quality indicator that you think is right to improve quality for the patients. How many of us have actually gone out and asked those patients, is this actually how you would think about quality? Are these the types of things we should be looking at? And I worry, and I think they would give us very thoughtfully different answers. Peter McLeod, he's done some amazing work, had some great sort of observations when I chatted with him this week. We need to do a better job of involving them and listening to them. And the other thing that's become very clear over just 7 weeks is there is no shortage of people involved in the quality agenda. Not in the least. And what there isn't, though, is a lot of coordination. There is not a lot of connecting the dots. You know, there was a great, several of us may have been at the Health Council of Canada pan-Canadian event about 3 weeks ago, and they had a great panel. And it was sort of interesting because I was on that panel, and one of the first questions that Ross Baker thoughtfully asked is, you know, what's going on in sort of quality improvement capacity building? And, you know, good question, like what are your agencies doing? And so, you know, as they moved across basically in Saskatchewan, they're like, well, you know, this is what we are doing as the agency, and, you know, nobody, that's, we're the only game in town in BC, so, you know, we're doing lean in Saskatchewan. And, you know, somebody else said, and another part of the country said, this is what we're doing, and this is, we're the quality council, and we take the lead. That's great. I said, wow. So let me tell you about Ontario. No, never mind Ontario. Let me tell you about one university in Ontario. I mean, there's a lot of universities, a lot of hospitals. So we have one university, University of Toronto. Just pick one. And one part of it, IHPME, which is here, it's omnipresent. Stanley Brown is here with us now. You know, they're running ideas. Over in the Department of Medicine, also part of the University of Toronto, Cave has a fantastic master's program. Cave also has a fantastic sort of 5-day course. And over at the University of Toronto, the Department of Family and Community Medicine, all part of the same university, we also have Phil Ellison's really, really good course. I've taken it. I'm a family doctor. I've taken that course. I've even had the privilege of participating in it. And so in one university, we've got sort of 5 or 6 courses right there. And we've got lots of universities and lots of hospitals and lots of people involved in the education and the quality game. We have lots of people collecting indicator work, lots of people collecting data. And, you know, sometimes it's because we have silos, sometimes it's because we just don't know what the other person's doing it, sometimes because there's, even when we know and we're not committed to silos and we want to get there, there just isn't that extra little bit of help to connect us and to find the time to bring us into the same room together. But, you know, we're actually going to do this. We really need to start just connecting the dots. And some of it means breaking down and getting over ourselves and working together. And some of it's just knowing what else is out there so we can work together, and some of it's then just having a little bit of extra help to actually do it once we see it and we want to do it. And Anil Bhattacharya has talked a lot about collective impact, and there's a great initiative. If you just put collective impact in Strive, there's a wonderful example of how this is being done in education in Cincinnati. There's lots of literature, but it really is at its core about the sum being greater than the parts, leveraging individual collectivity for a higher impact. And whether that's on the evidence, whether that's on monitoring and reporting, whether that's on scaling and spreading, whether it's on capacity building, we have to start playing together. There is not more resources. There isn't going to be another $4 billion to drive quality in the system. It is going to be about networking and better utilizing what we have. And finally, usually, at some point in the conversation, somebody asked this question, so I'm just going to put it out there. When are we actually going to have a culture? James Malosh asked this on my, I hadn't even started, 3 weeks before that I started. They said, why don't you come facilitate this session? And I was like, no, I'm really excited to go to HQO. Very generously, I said, yeah, you can have a morning and go, you know, get ready for your new job. I went to facilitate. It was all going well. James Malosh from one of the Lins stood up and said, when are we actually going to have a culture of quality in the healthcare system? When is culture going to be what everybody in the healthcare system puts first? And this is what we do. What we are committed to is a continuously improving culture that isn't just putting patients in the center, but right side by side with us on our journey, and every day committed to better improvement. So these are six things we need to do. The other thing we need to do is we need to resolve some really key tensions. So Roger Martin, and you know, really is internationally well-known local resource, wrote a book called The Opposable Mind. And this is a quote from the book. And he talks about the opposable mind as the ability to face constructively the tension of opposing ideas and hold these ideas together and actually not just feel like you have to choose or be paralyzed by this contradiction of positions, but actually find the opportunity to resolve those apparent contradictions to a higher end and to a higher solution. And you know, one of the things that happens when you go out and you meet a lot of people back to back to back and you have, you know, two or three cups of coffee in a row with different people is you start to hear about these tensions that exist in the system. And I'm just going to talk about a couple of them. So first of all, there's this tension between QI and accountability. So on the one hand, other people say, you know what, this is about frontline, rapid cycle, PDSA, we're just going to try it out here, we've got a problem, we're going to do something, and we've got to make it better, and this is about quality improvement, and we're just out there to get this right, and we're going to do a little test, and we're going to try it, and we're going to cycle through and PDSA it, and if it doesn't work, we're going to do it again. And then there's the issue of, you know what, when do we say, actually, if your volumes aren't at the right level, we're not actually going to let you do this anymore. We're going to actually say, this is so important that you can't ignore it. Hand hygiene, right? It'll take us back several hundred years. Atul Gawande wrote a great article recently in The New Yorker about, you know, just, and he's doing work in Africa, in India, sorry, about this, you know, hand hygiene and how do we do it? How do we sort of say, you know what, this is not optional to look at? We are actually going to look at hand hygiene. You can't just sort of say, well, you know, there's three other things we'd rather do. Hand hygiene, you know, when does the accountability, when do we actually say, you know what, I hear you, QI is about sitting down in a room and saying, what can we do better collectively? And when do we actually say, you know what, this is actually going to be tied, whether it's a Lean agreement, whether it's your CEO pay for performance, et cetera. When does this fall on that end? And how do we find the right balance and the right tension between these two things? Then the rapid cycle evaluation and the research. So I teach family medicine residents, and they are all now required to do a quality improvement project as part of their piece, and that's fantastic. And so I had two very interesting things happen when I saw this. And one is just a quick sidebar. One is that there was this really interesting dynamic where two different people, physicians, staff, supervising physicians, had been trained by two of those different programs that I mentioned at U of T a minute ago. And the problem was because those programs have slightly different frameworks and competency models, they actually, the two staff physicians who'd gone through their QI training, actually had a conflict in how they could guide the residents, because one went through one of the programs I mentioned and one went through the other, and they now were in tension because they're not coordinated on their competency framework. And so that was one interesting side. The other interesting thing was, you know, somebody stood up and sort of presented a very, very good research, you know, very good QI project, PDSA, and it sort of said, you know, we ended up moving from seeing, it was an access issue, as I recall, 33 patients to 37 patients over the 6 weeks on average per day in the clinic or something like that. So I sort of said from the back of the room, you know, remembering the teaching that Andreas gave me when I worked at ISIS, well, like, is that, like, significant? Like, you know, is this, well, like, what's the p-value on that? It wouldn't be too hard to calculate a p-value on that. And they said, well, you know what? It wasn't the resident, it was the staff. Said, you know what? We don't need to calculate p-values when we do QI work. We don't need to look at this. This is not research. This is not peer-reviewed publication. You know, this is just tests of change, and we do our best, and we take a look, and we sort of, you know, and we're not going to calculate people. And, you know, it's this very interesting thing between where does research and quality lie at one, and peer-reviewed, you know, virtual award, going to get into some awesome journal and really sort of high-end research, sort of New England Journal type JAMA stuff, and where do we do a bunch of people sitting around in a practice saying, you know what, we're really trying to improve this, this is moving us in the right direction, let's give it 3 more weeks and see if this continues to do a trend, or you know what, that just doesn't feel right, you know, these numbers look sort of flat to me, let's try something different, let's go to hand hygiene, hand wash. The next one is variation versus local autonomy. So I showed you a slide at the beginning with a 4.5 to 35% variation for one very specific patient population and procedure. And that type of variation to me seems hugely problematic. Hugely problematic. And so one of my visions for HQO is to help contribute to the dialogue and the discussion and the effort to reduce that variation. And partly also because last night at 11, one of my retired board members, Tom Clausen, sent me 3 of the latest articles from Lancet looking at surgical variation. Said, I think we should look at this. This guy's phenomenal. Like, this guy reads every journal. He's on every board. It's amazing. Like, my board's fantastic. I could not have a better board. But yes, this, you look at those C-section rates, you look at what Lancet's putting out this week, and you think that's a problem, right? Like, Tom Clausen, you were right. Like, this is a problem. On the other hand, I sort of sit in downtown inner city family health team with my patients, many of which who are Aboriginal, and I look at the primary care quality indicators, and I sit in a practice up at Sunnybrook until very, you know, until a few weeks ago with a very different type of population, and I can tell you that I think I need some very different foci between those two. I think, you know what, frankly, Ministry of Health, HQO, as a frontline clinician, the difference between working at Seton House and the difference at working at Sunnybrook, where the average age in some of our practices, like literally in the high 80s is the average age, and the number of medications is easily double digits as an average, like these need very, very different things. So don't come at me with some type of cookie cutter approach. So where's the tension between the eliminating the variation that we know kills inappropriately, and yet allowing the local autonomy to reflect local need and local reality? And how do we find, reconcile very, very valid tensions between, and you know, yes, I've got low volumes, but yes, I'm not focusing on hand hygiene, but frankly, when my patient population are the type of patients I talked about earlier with all these other things going on in their life, hand hygiene rates are maybe not our starting point for that particular group. Maybe it's a meal a day is the right outcome. And then finally is innovation versus scale and spread. So every, you know, I've been invited to I don't know how many innovation conferences over the last 3 years, and those are great. And some of them are small and some of them are big, but we innovate all the time. What we, I think, increasingly are learning is if you went back a year later, so let's say we go to one of our innovation conferences, and they present 30 abstracts and plenary sessions about the best of X. Like 300 people applied, we're giving you the best 30 that made the cut, and the best of those 30 actually get 20 minutes or 30 minutes or an hour of your time to present, and the rest of them get a poster, but we're gonna protect time for you to walk by the posters and learn about them. Then we're gonna send you out with an app and a USB key so you have access to them. Plus, we're gonna put them on one of our many innovation websites. Maybe it's Accreditation Canada's innovation website, maybe it's the CMA innovation website, maybe it's the Health Council of Canada innovation website. Pick your innovation website. It's going up on one of them. And you'll be able to have a contact name and all that. I would bet good money that a year later, if you went through that list of 30 special projects that were better than anything else that had been submitted, how many of them were now the standard of practice across the province? Right? We don't need to peer review this. Right? They're not there. So what point do we need to say, you know what, we actually have hundreds of examples of innovation that has good outcomes, that shortens length of stay, that drives down, that hits all the outcome measures, and actually focus on just spreading and scaling those. And at the same point, you never want to say, you know what, we've just decided enough innovation in Ontario. We're out. Right? We're just about spreading and scaling. You may have a good idea. I don't care anymore. I'm just spreading and scaling. Oh, that's brilliant. We don't innovate. We're about scale and spread, right? So how do we resolve these two tensions? So there's one more I'm going to talk about at the end, but before I talk to that, and I do want to have a couple minutes, Anton, at the end to go to our last slide, there's a few questions. Now, I'll talk about anything or try to talk about anything, but these are some of the questions that sort of continue to keep me up at night. There's actually about 50 more, but, you know. These are some of them, right? What are the missing opportunities in the quality agenda in Ontario? How do you differentiate between QI and accountability? How do you resolve some of those tensions? How do you think we find the opposable mind solutions to those tensions that I talked about? How can we make these quality improvement plans better? Because they've gone from hospitals to primary care teams. They're going to go into the rest of primary care, the long-term care, 650 of them are rolling out this year. The CCACs said, we want to play in the QIPs. We're going to do QIPs. Nobody's making us. We're in, though. And the community health group wrote us an email a couple weeks ago. So good news. We love QIPs. We're in, too. Surprise. Great. Okay. Surprised, but great. So on the one hand, everybody's starting to do these QIPs. On the other hand, what can we do to make sure that it's the best use of everybody's time? What does monitoring and reporting look like? What kind of data should we be looking at? And a lot of people, to the degree that it's about networking and partnering and breaking down silos or just saying, I don't want to be in a silo, I just want to work together, how can HQO be a value-add partner in that discussion? And you may have other ideas, or you may disagree with something, whatever, but I think, Anton, these are some thoughts that I had, but I'm open to any thoughts that anybody else has. And Anton, I think you were going to help us out here. And like I said, this is the great part. When I was sort of nervous about this part, but when I saw John and Jenny and Nathan and everybody walk in, we got lots of smart people. Susan's here. So fortunately, the team knew that I was a week seven and not ready. So they are here to answer the questions. So Anton, you take the question, and I will delegate out.
Yep. So
being a CEO is fun.
Not only that, but when you give a short presentation, you're amazing. Yeah. I don't know how you do that so short. We'll start right here.
Thanks, Anton. Great talk, Josh. And if creating a better future for everyone begins with understanding where we are, I think you did a really great job in the last little while reminding us of where we are and the challenges. So congrats on that. The one word I didn't hear, which is certainly a word that we're focusing a lot on at Mount Sinai, is team. Building high-performance teams and making sure they have all the tools they need to deliver the best quality at the lowest cost. Any thoughts on that?
Yeah, so one of the things I used to talk a lot about back in when I cared about health human resources, so yesterday, was teams, right? Interprofessional teams. And how do you build interprofessional teams? And I always used to say, we don't want teams just for the sake of having teams. We want teams because they do something different than what we have when we don't work in really high-performing teams. And they do a number of things. But one of the best things they do is drive quality. You know, when you have teams, healthcare provider injury rates go down, needle stick injury rates go down. This isn't just about the patients, it's about the hundreds of thousands of really amazing frontline healthcare providers every day. But also patient outcomes go up, and patient satisfaction goes up, hemoglobin A1Cs are more in control, INR are more within target range, surgical outcomes improve for endarterectomy. So we know the teams are incredibly important. Two or three quick thoughts for what that's worth. One is you can't just, functioning as a team is actually a learned skill. You can't actually just sort of say, you know what, I've read the article, teams are good, the six of you, you are now a team, go forth, right? Improve care, drive our quality indicators in the right direction, right? This actually takes, it's a skill ability, it's not something we were all trained to do, and so you have to invest in, and it takes resources, and it takes protected time, bullet rounds. Many, many people are doing, you know, time to release care, bullet rounds, et cetera. Credit Valley Trillium was doing some awesome stuff in that area. But that means actually restructuring your time, it's restructuring your day. So that's one thing. The second thing is it's not just about frontline clinicians. If you really want high-performing teams, it's about driving these teams throughout the management structure. I always used to say it was very ironic that we spend a lot of time at senior level saying, interprofessional care is the way to go. All of you go at the front lines and do it, but at senior management and the ministry, in our senior levels of the healthcare system, we couldn't function in a team. But we were very big on telling all those good frontline healthcare providers, you go out and do it. So high performing teams is about pervading that concept of team throughout throughout the lines, giving them skills and resources, and recognizing the value of teams and showing the evidence of the teams. There's a very, we actually wrote a healthy debate article, I co-authored it, which is online, around what is IPE, IPC, and the role of teams in a healthy debate. It's about 5 weeks ago. So I think they are absolutely part of the answer, but they will only be part of the answer if we're all part of those high-performing teams and if we skill and resource them appropriately.
Right, if I don't ask.
Thank you, Anton, and thank you, Joshua, for a really concise presentation. I was really struck by your thoughtful analysis around the first example you gave around the pager and the complexity that you discovered on that journey as you went through it for months, not just that moment when you were looking at the chart. Given that the minister, and we've heard it many times over, that primary care now is going to be kind of front and center in trying to establish health links as well as transforming the system and bringing them into their rightful place as a part of the system, not just on the periphery. What do you think would be essential or critical to really making the change take place in family health teams and within family practitioners, primary care providers? What needs to happen at a very core level from your personal experience and now in your new role?
Well, thank you for the easy question. Jenny, what were you thinking? No, I won't do that. I think part of what it is actually is there is no one answer. And one of the things that I think when we look at IHI or we look at readmission is it's actually talking about bundling. And I think, I think the more we think this is just about an electronic health record, this is more just about creating teams. If we just get a QIP in place so that we actually have some targets, if this is just about monitoring, if we think this is just about a thing, we probably won't fail. I think one of the things we need to recognize is this takes I think the IHA uses the word a bundle. I will talk about a quiver of arrows. If we think there is a silver bullet, it's not. It is an entire sort of fusillade of bullets that you need to line up against these quality agendas. And I think recognizing that the variety of things you need to bring into place, whether it's, like I said, getting an EHR that talks to other EHRs and that you can pull data out in a timely way. It's creating a better functioning team. It's involving the patient in the conversations and their families about what is quality, what is it going to mean in your practice. It's about doing some reporting and peer-to-peer feedback and getting your own results in a really timely way on a wide variety of indicators. And HQO is about to launch, in fact, is already piloting a system where across a whole bunch of indicators you can go on and confidentially just you log in and see how your practice lines up on a whole bunch of really important cancer screening indicators, a whole bunch of other factors, population health factors, immunization rates, preventative stuff, and see how you do relative to peers and LINs, and I'd love to get to the point of health links. And so, you know, that's another tool. So I think for me it is about combining a whole bunch of things. What I would say part of it, though, goes back to my culture slide. You know, culture eats structure and process for breakfast, lunch, and dinner, right? Culture is what trumps. Culture is what kills so many projects. So what do we also have to do is consciously say part of what we're going to do is move to a culture of quality. There are lots of people who talk about quality change and how you do change and drive a cultural change. And we have to recognize moving towards a high-performing, quality-based system that's continually improving is cultural change. Recognize it as the hard work it is and put that down as one of the things we do is say, we're going to change culture. That's hard, but we're putting that on our to-do list. And so that goes into that quiver of arrows.
We do have a mic on the other side as well, if anybody's interested on the other side. Here we go. I can't read. Oh, yes, I can, Kira. Kira Goodman, sorry.
Hi there. I just wanted to ask you a question. You've spoken a bit about the challenges that come along with changing culture. And it seems that we have a culture today that's a lot about evidence-based medicine. And that's great. But it also means that we focus a lot on randomized control trials and meta-analyses and things like that. So how do you see that aspect integrating with the fact that we have so much local complexity in the system? Do you see a way to marry the two?
I mean, that is one of the tensions I throw out there. How do you do this sort of local evaluation versus the really high-end research? I don't have an easy answer. I think this is one of our tensions. It's probably not an either or. Vincent Lam also spoke very nicely at our HQT conference about, you know, we don't have evidence in all areas and evidence carries me so far, but then there's the complexity of the individual or the ecosystem that's there, and how does that sort of build in? So I don't have an easy answer. I think that is one of these opposable mind tensions, and the answer is it's probably a bit of both. And we don't abandon the evidence, but nor do we say where there is no evidence, we don't act. It's how do we do a bit of both. Anton, I do have one more slide I want to make sure we get to. I trust you on time.
There's one more question right here.
Perfect.
So we'll take this last one and then go to your slide.
The last slide won't take long, but it is another sort of key issue.
It's wonderful to see healthcare finally get where manufacturing's been for about 50 or 80 years. And I'm not being funny, it needs to go there. If we study Kaizen, I think the answers are there. Two things struck me, and I research and work in knowledge management. Thomas Davenport at Boston U's got your answer on why Ontario is a world leader in talking about innovation. And it's a shame that we're only a world leader in talking. It's attention management. And Thomas Davenport has been very clear that we have to find space to have these ideas come through. If you're a busy physician or clinician or whatever you're doing, we are facing an exaflood of information. And so you expect me to go up to one of a dozen innovation websites to read what report at what time of my day, and I'm going to absorb it and change my daily practice tomorrow. I think that's an absurdity, and I think we're going to have to find space for these folks and a single point of access so these ideas can push some space outside. So these great ideas, which Ontario truly can come up with, can actually get put in place. But to throw this on top of busy clinicians without saying, I'm going to take this away, and this away from you, so you can have this reflection period each day, so tomorrow you can change your practice, I think that's where we got to go.
Thank you. I think that's a great thought.
Josh, 5 minutes is a long time, so we're going to take one more question.
I was hoping you would.
So I really liked your crystallization of the six opportunities and the tensions. I'm going to build off your response to that first question, where you said you can't just tell people to go out and form a team and expect it to happen. Similarly, we know that you can't just throw out a piece of evidence and expect it to be implemented. Where do you see, in your 7 weeks on the job, where do you see the biggest gaps from a capability for improvement perspective, and what do you see as HQO's role, either in taking the lead or in partnering in that whole agenda that I think is huge?
You know, I think it's a really helpful question. It's actually a great question to sort of start ending on. You know, I think for me, it really is on this area of scale and spread. And how do we actually help people take what we know, what has actually been shown to be really, really good, effective work, and take it to other places or bring it up to a higher, more pervasive level? And that, I think, is, you know, I think that's something we need to do. That's at HQO, whether it's on our website through our Quality Compass, which has a lot of evidence-based tools, or just tools that maybe haven't been rigorously evidence-based, but have a pretty good stamp of sort of use on them, or expert advice. So we've got the Quality Compass. We have the Best Path for the Health Links. We've created a discharge planning tool. We have a provincial coordinated care plan that's been developed with this. We have a whole bunch of tools that can be used, and we need to find a way to get them to the front line and to get them to the people who are looking for those tools. And then we have coaches around the province who are working one-on-one, because there isn't one way to solve this. There's a lot of different ways that people, change doesn't happen, you know, just as learning happens in different ways, and we all learn in slightly different ways, we all change and adopt and grow in different ways for different reasons. And so I think one of the things HQO needs to do, and you know, it's funny how many people have said this to me. Actually, Karen Michelle was the first one, but she was not the last one to say this to me. She said, we need HQO to be a bit of the glue. We need you to be those dots between the individuals on that picture I showed you. And so we need to be a bit of that glue to help the idea spread. We will continue to monitor and report. We will continue to drive evidence. But I think one of the biggest gaps is you know, one health link is doing something amazing. How do we get all 47 exposed and doing the same thing? Well, some of our best path tools and our coaches should be facilitating that. You know, we had a great meeting yesterday, actually, just to keep picking on Karen, this was one of her good ideas. She came in on day two or three and said, you know what, we've got Bridges doing some awesome innovation work. We've got the Arctic Cahill projects doing some awesome innovation work. We've got ideas in HPME, sort of capacity building. Like, how do we start connecting, you know, that's millions of dollars over several years wrapped up into just those three, just three. Millions of dollars from the ministry. How are we going to start actually leveraging that? And so that was on day two, and we got around yesterday, 4 or 5 weeks later, and we sat around for 2 hours and started to talk about how do you start to put the learnings, the expertise, the intellect, the bandwidth, the pulpits that we all have to start to leverage it, and how do we, and who's next around the table, and who else do we need to bring into this conversation? So that glue, you know, all I had to do was book a meeting room and get people in, and then the brilliance started to sort of take over from the people who walked through the door. But that glue thing is, I think, something HQO in part needs to be doing that needs to be done more of.
Josh and I are going to go to a meeting right around the corner here because we want to use Josh in the next Ways and Means conference, and he's agreed to do that. So we're going to have a meeting, and then that'll be in May. We haven't set the exact date, but if you want to block off all of May until we let you know when Ways and Means comes. So much appreciated, great presentation, Josh.
I just want to finish.
And you want to have one more slide?
Yep.
So then when you're done, just say done and thank you, and then we're out of here.
And you can sprint. So I talked a lot about tensions, right? And I talked about, I made it simple, dialectic tensions, right? Two things, very Maoist, you know, Marxian, two tensions. You just have to choose. This one's more complicated. So Most people should recognize this. This is the famous IHI triangle. This is the Berwick gospel. You know, if there's one thing I needed when I walked into my interview with Andreas, it was, you know, to be able to mention Berwick four times in the first sentence and talk about the triangle. It seemed to work. And research and evidence. But this is the IHI, right? This is, if you believe Berwick and IHI, and they seem to have something going. And what I just want to talk about is the other ones are two tensions, right? QI and accountability. That is relatively, you know, you only have to hold two opposing thoughts in your mind. This is the sweet spot on the quality agenda, and it is tough because it's three. And how do we focus on population care, health, the experience of care, and that per capita cost? And I think I just, you know, it's nice sometimes to leave on a good note. I'm going to leave you on a challenge. And our challenge is collectively to work together to fulfill the IHI mandate, the triple aim of finding that bullseye. Thank you so much for your time today.